Good morning on this glorious morning. Good to see everyone. Invocation words this morning will be offered by Richard Gilbert in a book he wrote called In the Holy Quiet of This Hour. In the midst of the whirling day, in the hectic rush to be doing, in the frantic pace of life, pause here for a moment. Catch your breath. Relax your body. Loosen your grip on life. Consider that our lives are always unfinished business. Imagine that the picture of our being is never complete. Do not let the incompleteness weigh on your spirit. Do not despair that imperfection marks your every day. Do not fear that we are still in the making. Let us instead be grateful that the world is still to be created. Let us give thanks for one another. And let's sing hymn number 7, The Leaf Unfurling in Your Gray Hymnal. We ask that you keep your masks on while you sing and rise as you are able.
Good morning, and welcome to First Parish in Milton. My name is Chris Clifford, and I'm a member of the Worship Committee. We are so glad you've chosen to be here with us this morning, or to join us virtually. However your journey, whatever your heritage, and whomever you love, you are welcome here. Your presence here on Sunday morning enriches worship for everyone. This sanctuary is made holy by your presence. If you're joining us for the first time, a special welcome. You'll find information about First Parish in your pew. One of the greeters or I would be happy to answer questions you might have. And any of us would welcome the opportunity to walk with you to coffee hour after the service. Today is a lovely day, so we will be having coffee hour in the courtyard. The work of living our faith is done both in and out of worship. So I call your attention to the printed announcements that came with your order of worship. Please take a look. In particular, please note this was a late edition. You would have seen it in your link, but Milton Muslim Neighbors have asked us for a second time to join with them in a Ramadan food drive. We do have a bin in the carriage house where you can drop items off. And if you check the link, you can get some more information. Now, let us take a few minutes to greet one another and extend a warm welcome to old friends and new. Of course, we do need to be COVID safe, so please stay in your seats and greet your friends as enthusiastically as you like, but stay where you are and please stay within COVID boundaries. And for those on Zoom, please show your faces to the gallery view so we can say hello to others Zooming in.
Hey everyone.
Hello.
What does as enthusiastically like?
That's what I thought. Like, da, 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 da.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Hey, Chris. Hey, everyone.
Hey. How's everyone? Ooh, cat.
Many cats.
Lots of cats.
Cats. Good morning.
Yep.
Morning, Deb.
Looks like you're cooking.
I am. I've got a birthday party, so I have to get my kids to worship, up for it.
Please take a moment to make sure your cell phones are
Hey, Mary. Hi, Patricia. Hi, Mark.
Good to see you guys.
Nice to see you guys.
Good to see you guys. I'm going to see Tom.
We'll do a Zoom call later if people want to come on. See ya.
Bye, Richard.
When we can choose to connect with the divine, when we can choose to just be present. Each Sunday, we light the chalice as a reminder that even in an increasingly unpredictable and dangerous world, the flame continues to shine, a corner of warmth and awareness where we, the members of this faith community, can find comfort, support, and connection to one another. Now, please join me in the call to worship. Come, let us gather. We gather to celebrate the sacred within and among us. We come to speak spiritual growth and understanding. We strive to practice acceptance, forgiveness, and love. Together, we work to build a world with justice and compassion. Come, let us gather. And now a story for all ages.
So today is Palm Sunday. Our brothers and sisters and siblings in Christian churches all over the world are celebrating Palm Sunday. And we have Judeo-Christian heritage in ours, so we also observe this celebration of Palm Sunday. And what that story is the story of Jesus walking into Jerusalem to basically bring his ministry into the mainstream. And the rest of the week from that entrance is a very, very interesting story. But today we're going to work on the entrance together. And have you ever noticed that when you're in a room or somewhere and someone walks in and you just notice them and the presence of the room changes, the mood of the room changes, or it has another bit of energy about it? Anybody ever notice that we bring not only ourselves, but we bring a sense of ourselves, and that we connect in ways that aren't verbal, right? So I thought we'd kind of demonstrate that for each other right now. So I want to ask for 4 volunteers. It is a very simple task, but it is people that might want to do a little something for the congregation. Just takes a little bit of walking and a little bit of imagining. So 4 people, come on up, come on up. Come on up. Perfect, perfect, perfect. So choose a side, either that side or that side. 2 on either side. Wait, sort of where Leslie is. All right. Now, what I'm going to ask you all to do, I'm going to give you a card. And I'm going to ask you to walk in with the mood that's on the card. And then we're going to have the congregation guess what the mood seems to be. Okay? So. Okay. One second. Oh God, did you hear that because I'm on? So now what we're going to do is just pay attention to how a friend that's coming into our space enters. Keep going all the way across. Okay, so what do you think that was? Mad, angry, good, yeah, well done. Right? So then there would be this like, ooh, there's anger in the room, right? Okay. Excited, joyful, right. Okay, so now, oh, the place feels a little different, doesn't it? Okay. So what do we have there? God, you guys are good. Well, and you are good too. You're doing good. What do you think? Nice. Wonderful. Thank you very much for the demonstrations. And this was not planned, it was improv. Okay, so part of the point of the Palm Sunday story is how Jesus entered Jerusalem. Because the way he entered Jerusalem told a whole bunch about who he was and what his ministry was. So one of the things that he did do is that he, before he came, he asked a disciple to get him a donkey. So I'm going to bring the donkey back to our Jesus. Okay, so now Jesus has a donkey and is going to enter. Now, let me give you a little bit of background. This is a time when Jesus was getting more and more popular because of the teachings he was giving, which was basically, you are good. What you have wisdom inside of you. You do not need other people to tell you who you are and why you are and whether you should be happy, right? And so authority were kind of not really liking this, folk in power, because the way we can control people the easiest is to tell them that they're not worth it, that they don't deserve it, or that they should be afraid, right? And Jesus was starting to say, nope. So when he was coming in, there were authorities that were worried, and many of the people in the crowd that were going to greet him kind of considered him their king, their spiritual king. So what they did when he entered is they shouted, Hosanna! Hosanna! And some put palms down on the path or coats down on the path. So now I need you all to practice Hosanna. Let's try it. Hosanna! Hosanna! Perfect. Okay, so how do you think Jesus entered? Did Jesus enter like he was all that, like he was king? Hosanna! Hosanna! No, back. He did not enter. Okay, so did Jesus enter knowing that he had influence now? Like an influencer, a glad hand, or someone that you needed very much to know who he was, someone who could, you know, get you where you want to go. Is that how Jesus entered? Hosanna! 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 No, 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 no! So the way Jesus entered, which already getting a donkey was already saying that he didn't get a royal carriage or anything. He's coming in, and you remember that Mary and Joseph traveled to Bethlehem on a donkey in a humble way. So already he's traveling in a humble way, and he enters to the hosannas in this way. Hosanna! 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 Thank you very much. So what do you think that says? What do you think this entrance said? Just guess. He's one of us. Humble. Yes.
Difficult life.
Difficult life. That praising him wasn't the point. Praising him is not the point of his ministry. And that's how he entered into Palm Sunday. So thank you, everybody. So now you all are going to be sung out to your classes. Do need recognition and praise sometime. But one of the things that we have that we're given in our lives is our being, is our body, is our breath. Invited to breathe with trees, invited to ease into the grounding of our being. That always is with us. So let's take a little time in stillness. Just settle yourselves into your body and nourish your being. And, you know, whatever thoughts are going through, just kind of let them pass through. Don't judge them. Don't think you're a wrong person for thinking them. Just go, oh, well, not now. Right now I'm breathing. Just for a little bit. And I'll start with a chime.
This morning's reading, When He Came, Reflection Number 10, by Dorothy Sowell. I don't know, as they put it, believe in God, but to Him I cannot say no, hard as I try. Take a look at Him in the garden, when His friends ran out on Him, His face wet with fear, and with the spit of His enemies, Him I have to believe. Him I can't bear to abandon to the great disregard for life, to the monotonous passing of millions of years, to the moronic rhythm of work, leisure, and work, to the boredom we fail to dispel in cars, in beds, in stores. That's how it is, they say. What do you want? Uncertain, but not uncritically. I subscribe to the other hypothesis, which is His story. That's not how it is said, for God is, and He staked His life on this claim. Thinking about it, I find one can't let Him pay alone for His hypothesis, so I believe Him about God. The way one believes another's laughter, His tears, or marriage, or no for an answer. That's how you'll learn to believe Him about life, promised to all.
And He staked His life on this claim, wrote feminist theologian Dorothy Sowell, that God is. Thinking about it, I find one can't let Him pay a loan for His hypothesis. And Chinese poet Xu Ting writes, perhaps because of our irresistible mission, we have no choice. What is that irresistible mission that has you get up in the morning? What compels you to walk into the day, to insist somewhere in your being to the worthiness of life, assist in the adventure? You come here knowing deep within there is a way through. You come here knowing that wholeness can be found, that harmony has a fulfillment that you are a part of. Though we doubt, we deeply doubt, and we're afraid, we are often afraid. Today, our Christian sisters, brothers, and siblings are celebrating Palm Sunday. It's the beginning of the Christian Holy Week, which rounds out into Easter and the embrace of everlasting life. This week's journey symbolizes a path toward spiritual wholeness, an entrance into resilience and resurrection. Through metaphor and witness, messages of hope and strength are offered. Through a willingness to be changed by giving over to a sense of life that knows no death, we open to a shared experience beyond our individual reach. We are not alone. We are not abandoned. And it starts from a humble beginning. Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee, rides into Jerusalem on a donkey, so legend goes, with intentional resistance to fanfare, to bring his message into the heart of Palestinian culture under the Roman rule of King Herod. Jesus was not highlighting the message of his celebrity, rather the message of his ministry. The mystical meaning of Jerusalem is known as habitation of peace, an abiding and boundaryless place of peace, Jerusalem. Jesus entered Jerusalem to empower wisdom for the way of peace and harmony for all. And what is the first thing he does after discouraging the acclaims of Hosanna, admonishing people away from the dependence of idol worship and into the responsibility of their own lives? What is the first thing he does? Well, he goes to the temple, the religious and economic focal point of the city, to turn the tables of the money changers over, to get that attention and then teach to a new way of seeing. My house shall be called a house of prayer, legend has him saying, but you make it a den of robbers. Already, for those who were paying attention, he has modeled and embodied paradigm shifts. Move away from hierarchy, pedestals, hero worship. Stop giving your lives over to another's judgment of your worth, and look to your habituation, look to the priorities of your life. You want to know the way to peace, his actions were saying? Pay less attention to who I am and more attention to what you are doing. What are you putting in the center of your lives? What are you worshiping? How are you living your relational power? Jesus got right down to soul business. Pay attention to your choices, to your preferences, to your actions for and with one another. His actions were saying, you're missing the point. You will not see the way to peace as long as you stay in competition and scarcity, deception and expedience, predatory behavior and victimology, the turning over of the tables. My house shall be called a house of prayer, but you make it a den of robbers. And what was being robbed? Our soul's wisdom, our natural relationship of self in harmony with the sacred nature of life we are in. So Jesus enters Jerusalem, most likely knowing his presence signaled great danger to his life. He entered to offer his message of what has been translated the kingdom of God within, our inborn wisdom of ultimate harmony. At another time, it was said that he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. This quote was attributed to Jesus, but it was not a declaration of his specialness, right? It was an assurance that we all can find that grounding, that wisdom in our being. If we shift the paradigm, shift the way we look at life and the path of our living. He enters Jerusalem offering himself as metaphor for the path toward that spiritual grounding, that wholeness. And in the beginning, the public is shouting Hosanna, right? And projecting a savior onto this man who is doing his level best to empower the people to find their own strength and a sense of the holy within them. He makes a ruckus in the center of town where it hurts the most, their wallets, to urge an awakening that could transform society. He rode in with his truth, his wisdom, his way of being, in the faith that those who have eyes to see and ears to hear can shift their way of being. And too many did not understand, too many did not see. Too many wanted to keep their power, and too many wanted to keep the people ignorant. So they schemed to eliminate the hailed Prince of Peace and hopefully his message. And as crowds often go, many then followed that false witness and within days turned on him with crucify him. And this is where I feel his ministry was almost lost. Not because he was executed, though that is tragedy beyond measure. Let alone we may have had more opportunity to learn from him. Buddha preached for 50 years. Jesus's followers had 3 years to try and understand a complete reworking and a sense of being and a sense of life with one another. What dampened the paradigm-shifting possibility of Jesus's ministry was not that he was killed. It happened later in making him God, which became a solidified notion in the form of dogma some 300 years after his death. Naming Jesus God, any more than the rest of us can be, diverted his radical preaching of inherent worth and our ability to come to the knowledge of God, the way of the peaceable realm, which he insisted was within all of us. When we make Jesus God, we let ourselves off the hook. We say, yeah, what he was and did was a great gift, but it's beyond our ability since we're just limited mortals. And besides, he died for us. No, he died because of us, because of what we did and didn't do. And he loved us and the integrity of his message unto death. So we fall short of taking on his call to call to the knowledge of God, to come to the knowledge of God that he was modeling, teaching, and demonstrating. God in relation, God in all being. A call he gave us unto death. A call of embodied love for the way, the truth, and the life that he found and summoned for those with eyes that see and ears that hear. And you know, don't get me wrong, Jesus was an extraordinary person, of course, a spiritual genius, a bodhisattva, an enlightened human being. He had what's traditionally called God down, so to speak, more than most of humanity, but to place him on a distant celestial pedestal bears false witness to the liberating, courageous, wise, and radically loving ministry he lived. This ministry he lived was introduced in the first Sermon on the Mount, some 3 years before his entrance into Jerusalem. That first public sermon spoke of seeing God in each other and gave principles of relating toward that knowledge, how we could practice into the knowledge of seeing God in each other, that possibility of radical harmony and spiritual wholeness. He was sharing a way toward salvation from emptiness, healing from brokenness, and dismantling violence toward self and other. Very soon into the sermon comes the phrase, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." See God, he was saying, all around us, all within us, all about us. You simply need to get out of your way and practice principles of relating that bring about a justice-centered life, a life for spiritual freedom for us all. In this first public sermon, he spoke of how we need to start small and notice early. Start in the beginning, he said, at the seed of violence, which is an unresolved disagreement. Don't indulge it. Don't let it grow. Resolve it. At the beginning of dishonesty, he preached, don't venture there. At the thought of disharmony, don't follow through. And pay attention, notice how you are with yourself and each other. Notice what you value and how you spend your day. Notice what you are nourishing, for it is what guides your next choices and so your being. That was the Sermon on the Mount. And there are a lot of teachings in this sermon that we often hear of. Judge not, lest ye be judged. Turn the other cheek. Love your enemies. Challenging us with countercultural messages that call us to shed our shame and blame, our accusation and defensiveness, our helplessness, our fears and divisiveness. We create culture incrementally, bit by bit, from thought to action. We build upon what we choose to be true, what we choose to be our priorities. Start at the beginning, he said. Take care of your relational power to self, other, and the grand invitation for all to live. And Jesus was preaching to folk who were poor, disenfranchised, under the authority of others, in need of hope. And couldn't we use some hope right now from what's going on in the world right now? Couldn't we use some hope? Couldn't we use some assurance that God is, that justice is, that harmony is in the midst of the terror and atrocities and injustice that plagues humanity? Start small, Jesus preached. Plant seeds, see the tender beginning that can be nourished into full life. So I thought we could just take a bit from this week. Some things from this week that might shift our oppressive habits of being. Because we need to practice seeing the possibility of shifting the way we are with one another, the destructive habits. Ketanji Brown Jackson, first black woman to be confirmed as a justice of the Supreme Court. Take that in, nourish it. Celebrate its courage, its paradigm-shifting possibility. Countless people around the globe taking in refugees, sending support to those suffering from adversity. Countless, countless people bringing their lives to this need. Take that in. Nourish it. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change offered its report last Monday. Amidst sobering and scary statistics of accelerated environmental doom, it urged a paradigm shift from vested interest and financial bottom line to concentrating on services and lifting folk out of poverty. This would radically affect our use of fossil fuels by up to 80%, simply by seeing ways to support life rather than profit from it. An international voice is rising to not only pay attention to environmental statistics, but to change the way we relate to one another, citing the need for service to one another, disrupting the paradigm of competitiveness and profit to actually keep humanity alive on this planet. Take that in. Nourish it. Now, this is being said out to millions, out loud to millions. More are seeing this and hearing this every day. So what bit of kindness or tenderness or forgiveness or advocacy can you see in your life and practice in your days that could grow the peaceable realm? This is what Jesus was urging. Claim and shape your lives together. God is. In the words of Dorothea Zola again. Thinking about it, I find one can't let him pay alone for his hypothesis. So I believe him about God. The way one believes another's laughter, his tears, or marriage, or no for an answer. That's how you'll learn to believe him about life promised to all. So may it be. Amen. Let's sing together hymn number 1017, Building a New Way, in the blue hymnal. Let us join our hearts in the spirit of prayer. Holy One of all being known through many wisdoms, through Jesus' love and justice and being and sacrifice, today we honor you. Thank you for the courage to be, for the assurance of life's worth, for seeing beyond celebrity to human dignity. Thank you for your astounding message of your life and the presence of your ministry in your death. And let us be grateful for one another, for the reaching out in love, for all the ways we are using our resources to help others, for even getting up in this hard, disruptive, helpless creating time and just taking a next step forward. Because if we all do it, that strength will stay alive. Let us be gentle in our brokenness and bold in our love. And for all the prayers lifted up right now, unspoken, let us wrap it in a cloak of love to mind all our lives. Amen.
Powers, Executive Director of the Back Bay Coral Bridges. The Back Bay Coral is a 120-member auditioned chorus which hosts an annual concert series. BBC shares music with the Boston community through its Bridges program, which offers an ESL program to make music and improve English language skills for participants. Suzanne Powers, Executive Director, is going to speak on behalf of the organization.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for welcoming me. I'm Susanna Powers, Executive Director, and I'm here by invitation of my good friend Dottie Pitt, who's a beautiful singer in the Back Bay Chorale. We do run the ESL program. It's a outgrowth of the, it's a community engagement outgrowth of the Back Bay Chorale. It's a singing ensemble for English as a second language learners in partnership with the Boston Public Library at Copley Square. We meet once a week. And amazingly, during the COVID pandemic, the ESL program didn't miss a beat and switched to Zoom and attracted that way learners of English from all over the globe. We have participants from Japan, Italy, Brazil, Vietnam, Thailand, and it is a very vibrant community now. We are switching back to in-person sessions now, and we've kept many of the friends we've made in the past 2 years. What this looks like, I'd like to share a little bit what we do exactly on Tuesday mornings. We sing together music that is chosen by our Director of Community Engagement, Catherine Chan. She herself is an immigrant from China who emigrated to Australia and now lives in the US. I am from Germany, I am also an immigrant, and very familiar with how scary learning English is and how embarrassing it is to make a fool of yourself when you try to express yourself and you're saying absolute garbage and people are very nice to you. But I, of course, learned it when I was much younger. I came from Germany to New York when I was 19 years old. And you're very intrepid at that age, of course. Plus, you're engaged with other students, and so making friends is very easy. When you're an adult and you don't speak English, it is very intimidating. And when you cannot express yourself, you are often perceived as stupid because you cannot tell them what you need. You don't have that voice. You cannot advocate for yourself. You are not on equal footing with the person you are speaking to actually communicate what you're trying to achieve. So what we offer at the public library is a very welcoming program where we practice English through singing, which is very disarming, and you can practice the vocabulary without any fear of making mistakes. It's very repetitive, we are joyful, we are welcoming. Then we engage in conversation where we offer opportunity for people to actually practice their English skills, which can be a challenge when you live in a country where you don't have friends maybe that take the time to practice your skills. So then this is provided by volunteers from the Back Bay Chorale who come to the library in the morning and build groups, and we sing together, we form friendships, we laugh together, We invite them to share about their lives, and then we sing more together. And what struck me, what Reverend Ward said earlier, that it is a place where we celebrate their worthiness as equals, where they are not less, where they are not afraid, where we promote that hour of being completely at peace with where they are in their journey in this country, welcomed and as equals. So we're trying to expand to a second time. We run this program once a week. We want to run it twice a week in an evening where we might increase our demographic to adults who work during the day and they can come after work and enjoy forming friendships with us and practice the English skills and sing. And Dottie is helping us with technology and logistics and friendship and keeping us, she's our den mother. And I'm very grateful to her. So thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak to you. Thank you.
So this morning's offering will be going to the Back Bay Coral Bridges Program. How to give? Simply text 617-539-7576 on your cell phone with the amount you'd like to give. Don't add words, simply put the amount. If you haven't done it already, you'll get an automatic text message back asking you to do a one-time setup. You'll create an account with a credit or debit card number. After the one-time setup, you can simply text the number with an amount you'd like to give, and it will be automatically debited from the account of your choosing. This is contained and safe and goes directly into a dedicated First Parish fund where it will be dispersed to the organization. Also, we have a traditional plate in the front and the back, so if you'd like to give in the traditional way, you may certainly do that.
Let me make the songs for the people, songs for the old and young, songs to stand like a battle cry wherever they are sung. Let me make the songs for the weary amid life's fever and fret, till hearts shall relax their tension and careworn brows forget. Not for the clashing of sabers, for carnage nor for strife, but songs to fill the hearts of all with more abundant life. Let me sing for little children before their footsteps stray, sweet anthems of love and duty to float o'er life's highway. Our world so worn and weary needs music pure and strong to hush the jangle and discords of sorrow, pain, and wrong. Music to soothe all its sorrow till war and crime shall cease, and the hearts of all grown tender, girdle the world with peace. Let me make the songs for the people, songs for the old and young, Songs still stand like a battle cry wherever they are sung. Let me make the songs for the weary amid life's fever and fret, till a heart shall relax their tension and careworn brows forget.
Today, we're inviting one another to partake in communion with the church silver. It's a ritual that was believed to be offered by Jesus at what has been named the Last Supper. With this ingenious ritual, he encouraged the receiving of his message through body wisdom, beyond words, beyond analysis, beyond external authority. Embodiment is a political act. It strengthens resilience to fear, which is what is used to control others. When we ground in our body wisdom, we are in touch with our inner truth and the true source of spiritual nourishment. The truth is in you, and we are connected, he was saying, offering this metaphor for radical resilience to tyranny through a ritual of nourishment. So I want to ask a few folk to come up to help me administer that we've already chosen. And then, as it says in the order of worship, I'd ask you to, if we're anyone who would want to come up the center aisle and then go around. We are going to we have bits of bread already fixed, and gluten-free and grape juice are on this side, and regular bread, yeast bread, and wine is on this side. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for the love and justice, he sat down at the table with those that had become family. At that table, there were those who adored him and those who would betray him. He knew this, and he gave bread to all anyway. Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup and invited all to drink as a sign of mutuality and resilience. This cup is the new covenant, poured out in my blood for you. Drink this in remembrance of me. So please come to take of communion the cup of love and the bread of hope. for the nourishment of our lives, for the nourishment of our being, for the nourishment of Jesus' ministry. May we be grateful. Let us sing closing hymn number 1018 in your blue hymnal, Come and Go With Me. Come and go with me to the light of each dawn awaken wonder in you and stir new appreciation for our capacity for sacred connection. As I douse the flame of our faith, let it stir deep and wide within you and bring you into your days in gladness. Have a good week. Amen.